Hello to you and welcome to the Business Roundup for this week. My name is Viola Xasia. On this segment, we analyze events happening in the world of business in detail just so you and I can understand them further. We are joined by Paul Busharizi, and he is a business journalist with The New Vision to help us do this tonight. Thank you, Paul, for joining us. Let's start off with government, which has given out 2 trillion Uganda shillings to suppliers that have been giving them, you know, several products. And keep in mind, there is 8 trillion in debt. So what does this mean, giving out just 2 trillion, but you're not clearing a date? And what's the time frame? Also, how is this going to be used?
Well, this 2 trillion, it's a bit of a bittersweet pill, because the Minister of State for Finance announced this on Thursday with 8 days to go in the month. Suppliers are supposed to access this or send in their vouchers, their invoices before the 30th. He said this on the 22nd. In the 8 days between the 22nd and the 30th, there are two days of the weekend and one public holiday. So effectively, they have like 5 days only to do this. So it's kind of bittersweet. However, it should be welcome relief for businessmen who have supplied government to get paid this money. The importance of June 30th is that if the money is not claimed by June 30th, it goes back to the consolidated fund and, you know, will be used next year and what. But also will increase our debt, our domestic arrears to the businessmen, which is already more than 8 trillion shillings.
What's your comment about the mode of payment by which government obtains products, but also how they handle this? I feel like it's a contributor to the domestic debt that is always, you know, announced in every single budget that we've had. How do you feel about the ways that government pays for its services?
Yeah, I mean, it's in my mind, it's just a scandal of this this government. We claim to be a private sector driven economy, but we are killing our private sector by not paying them off for services they deliver. The sooner we do this, 8 trillion is a lot of money. If you paid off that 8 trillion, let's say like in 4 years, it would make a world of difference. And especially since government is trying to increase revenue collections, it's these businessmen who pay us the taxes. So it only makes it seems obvious to me, and common sense, that government should pay the businessmen what is due to them.
Thank you for that, Paul. Let's now switch gears to where India, which is a part of the BRICS, a group of countries that is seeking an alternative to the US dollar as a means of exchange, has allowed traders in Uganda to obtain goods and services paying using the Indian rupee. So we understand the BRICS is trying to find a common currency that is not the dollar. So we are now beginning to see countries seeking to be paid within their own currency. What does this mean for the entire, you know, world trade? As well as what do you see happening if we keep up with this trend of countries wanting to have, you know, maybe countries or regions paying with a certain amount of money as well as a certain currency that is not the dollar?
So one of the reasons why, you know, maybe the US dollar is dominant, just one of the reasons, is confidence. You're confident that, first of all, you can get a supply of dollars. You know, chances are you're not going to have a shortage of dollars. And you're confident because the currency is a pledge by the government that whoever gets this piece of paper or whatever, the government is good for it. So that's why the US dollar is dominant. One of the reasons the US dollar is dominant, being the biggest economy and all that kind of business. So attempts to break that dominance, of course, are understandable because, you know, people feel, you know, as you said, it's kind of a monopoly and probably the fate of the dollar is not within their hands. That being said, attempts to use alternative currencies, like you mentioned now, India has allowed us to pay for our imports in rupees. It raises a question of convertibility. For example, Uganda shillings. Who wants to hold Uganda shillings? You know, maybe the Indians don't want to hold Uganda shillings. Of course, it's a measure of how much trade we do with India. Do we do enough trade with India that India finds it in its own interest to keep stock of Ugandan currency? I think it's a good idea in the sense that the better idea would have been that why don't we just pay in Uganda shillings? That would be even the better idea, so we don't have any exchange losses and all that kind on our part. It would probably be on their part. You know, the next best thing, of course, is for us to pay in rupees. But the reason why we're also saying that is because originally what we currently do is we buy dollars, then we go to India with the dollars and we change them into rupees to buy the stuff. So why don't we, that's an exchange loss, a double almost exchange loss. Why don't we just cut it down to one? It makes sense. Let's see how it works out.
All right, thank you so much. We shall keep an eye out for that, seeing how regions do adapt away from the US dollar that's been very dominant. And thank you very much once again for making time to be a part of the Business Roundup. Thank you, dear viewer, for making time. It's a Business Roundup every Friday here on the news. My name is Viola Xasia. Back to the news.